idea for an Overwatch healer, per Heroes, and oh, Jesus.
What if I don't want a hillbilly? This is Core.
Hey everybody, it's Core. Scott Johnson here with Bo Schwartz, John Jagger. I don't know what episode this is, 34? I guess it is. And we're going to talk about Heroes of the Storm. But before we do, you can't just ignore the elephant in the room or the roadhog in the room. He's the fattest one, so I thought elephant, roadhog, you know. This was launch week, or this is at the tail end, or I guess the exact week from when Overwatch launched. And I hate to say it, we all knew this was going to happen a little bit, but it really cut into my Heroes time more than I would have liked. So I'm hoping we get some later tonight. But yeah, Overwatch, a threat, a real threat out there, a winner by all accounts. People love it, universally being celebrated by the gaming press and players alike. And good job, Blizzard, and hurry up and make some of those Heroes into Overwatch. That'd be great, as long as they're good and not terrible like this gnome we got right now. And that's all I got to say about that. Except I want to ask you guys how you feel about the launch. Was it a good week for everybody, John? Did you enjoy the Tuesday-to-Tuesday celebration that was Overwatch?
I did. I loved it. I mean, some might say it ate up 100% of my Heroes' time. Mm. It really pulled me in, which is weird because we've had it for so long.
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense on paper that a thing that they only took away for like a week or two, suddenly they said, all right, it's out, and all of a sudden I was way back in and reinvested in spending all my time in this game. But I was, and I did, yeah. And I spent more money on a game I already spent money on, and, you know, things happened,
yeah.
Boxes were opened,
yeah.
And I had a real good time.
Yeah, one of us in this room spent real money on boxes. I'll let everyone guess who that may have been.
Was I the only one who did
it? I think you were the only one that did it.
Crap.
So far, I should say. So far.
Okay.
Bo, your take on the proceedings? Did you enjoy the launch?
I had fun playing Overwatch. This is sort of the dual edge of being in the beta and having played it ample is that I played it and it wasn't as special as I think is for a lot of people who are just playing it this week.
Well, yeah, you've had it since what? I mean, I know. Trying to think. We had it since BlizzCon. You got it not too long after the first open beta.
I guess it was open beta weekend. Mm-hmm. I got an invite.
And you zoomed ahead of everybody in levels. Like, you were killing us all.
I played, like, I put in 3 or 4 24-hour days. play, sleep for, like, 4 hours and get back to it. So I have played it a lot.
Yeah.
It's a great game. It's very successful. But I found I wasn't as, I need to spend all my time in Overwatch. I spent a bit of time in Heroes, lamenting that no one was playing Heroes with me this week.
Can you explain? Actually, I'm glad you brought that up, because while you were in Heroes, I noticed you've been playing Lili for some reason. And
yeah. That
seems not weird to me, but I'd never heard you ever in the past say, man, I got to get me some time with Lili. You're not really a support guy anyway in terms of your favorite class to play in the game. And so of all of them, I thought, you know, Morales maybe or Karazim, because you love those two. But Lili, like, what happened there? Tell us about this.
Well, I'm working through getting all my characters to level 10, right? Mm-hmm. Like, just as a little thing. I want to put in the time with all the characters. I want to have the option to buy the master skins if I want to.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you re-fall in love with characters you haven't played in a long time. And I'm sort of scraping the bottom of the barrel in terms of heroes I, like, really want to play. You know, like, all those heroes are already level 18 or whatever. Mm. And Lili turned out to be a lot of fun. Mm. And I forgot, because Lili kind of, I don't know, she's just a little girl. It's like, you don't play, like, these games and be like, I want to be a little girl. Maybe you do, but, I mean, you know.
Right, it's not your role play. It's not your go-to role play. It's not like, all right, I'm into this new badass thing. There's this Nexus, and, you know, there's Stitches over here, and he's trying to kill the Lich King, and it's really great and everything, and I just feel really badass, so I'm gonna play this toddler over here. It does seem weird. I agree.
And it's not like she's a badass toddler that is like murdering people. Like, you know, like I'm thinking of like the character from Borderlands, the little girl with the big mech that she has, for example, or whatever, the younger girl.
Oh, right.
You know, there are characters that are like young, but they're also insane or deranged usually, and, you know, murder people. She's like Lili. She's fundamentally a great person. She's a good human being.
Yeah.
Panda being. And oops. Yeah, but she's also extremely trolly. So this is a little tip for you guys if you want to win more games and have fun trolling people. There are a lot of assassins in your quick match games and no healers. Or I guess if you get a support, you're playing versus another support. But I don't know. Just that there's a lot of basic attack champions, auto attack champions, and her blind is amazing. I've discovered specifically timing the blind correctly is a real backbreaker, and I never really appreciated it before. So once I started getting the swing of that, I just wanted to keep playing her a lot.
You're making me want to play Lili now. I didn't expect to feel that way in today's episode, but maybe it's time we all gave Lili another chance, you know? It's not like she was a bad hero. We just always assumed, like, here's the assumption, and let's play with this assumption for a second and either shoot it down or say I'm right, because I'll take either at this point. Rainer. Hello, and welcome to Heroes of the Storm. Let me introduce you to your standard-ass damage dealer. He's your damage man, okay? That's how I see Rainer. And Rainer's got a lot of nuance, but he is presented as your easiest-to-get-into guy. He's your Jaina in Hearthstone. He's your Hunter in World of Warcraft. He's your Soldier 76 in Overwatch, okay? In my opinion. Then you got, all right, hey, tankers, you want to do some tanking, do you? How about a little Lich King over here? Arthas, he's your man. He feels like default standard guy to me. Maybe Mirrodin a little bit, but mostly him. Then when you say support in the game, your head goes straight to Lili because it's just like spam heals. You don't have to be real specific about it. There's no skill shots for the healing, really. You've learned, obviously, there's nuance with blind and other abilities and stuff, but she seems like your entry-level thing. Is that not fair to see her that way? Was she not built to be the panda who would bring you in carefully into the world of support in Heroes of the Storm?
Yeah, right, because healing is just pressing Q a lot.
Yeah.
Just press that Q button.
Yeah, she's a Q-er, for sure.
Yeah.
All right, so I'm not wrong then. John, you agree?
I completely agree. I don't know if I agree with Arthas as default tank man, but that's not what this is about.
Well, who would you give that to out of all the tanks now? Because it seems like, especially early on when we had less of them overall, he just seemed like, well, I know him. He's the Lich King. I'll play that guy. He has a sword. You know, like it just seemed that way.
Yeah, but maybe early on he might not. I don't know. Muradin's a good choice, but he does have some skill shots and stuff. Maybe Johanna now, just because her abilities don't necessarily require too much complexity to tank well.
Yeah.
She's a walking health pool, basically.
Yeah. Yeah. She kind of can't
put
help
a health
but
bar there and move it around.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Maybe Johanna.
Okay. So these are our entry points, and I am willing to admit that I have a bias against them. Like, I have a built-in, like, I don't trust the tutorial characters in my mind. And I just think they're just like too, I don't know, you just feel like easy mode or something. It's just a mental thing. I realize that because Blizzard doesn't, they're not going to build a big complex character just to be a throwaway after the tutorial. They don't do that. And they never have done that. And Jaina is a great viable thing in Hearthstone. And Rainer is maybe the best auto attacker in the game. And, you know, there's all these praises you can give to each of these characters we've mentioned. So I am officially going to play more Lili. I got her on sale once. I kind of let her just sit there. Had fun with her in some ARAM, but never really did much else with her. Bo, you've made me realize that it's time to embrace my inner Lili and let go.
She's got that sweet shadow pan skin, I think, that actually is the only look she has that is kind of badass. So you could deck her out that way and play.
She looks like your rebellious daughter or something like that in that thing. But
yeah. And the one thing I would say to counter the easy thing is that to make you feel good about playing easy characters is that if you are you know, trying to climb uphill to have a good win rate with a hard hero, you have to work more. It almost makes more sense to play easier characters as long as they're viable, because then you have an easier, your opponents have to work harder and you're not sweating as much. It's, I don't know, it's like having short legs in basketball or something, you know, like, like, yeah, that guy, he's pro and he worked really hard to be basketball. Meanwhile, you're a monster. It's just, I don't know, I'm just good at basketball. Just throw them in, you know, like, if it's better to be that guy. So you can kind of pick your hero, and if you pick easier heroes, you can do better with them, and it's okay.
Well, good news is, if you don't like any of what we just said and you're wanting the new hotness, that's right around the corner, probably, I don't know, not next week, maybe the week after, maybe next week. Medivh, I always say Medivh. Medivh. important lore-based Warcraft mage man, specialist, and now we know more about what he does. So, Bo, why don't you tell us his core stuff, what's Q through E and all that, what's going on with him?
We did cover it before.
Did we go through it? I can't remember if we did everything.
But I have the right names now. Although I still kind of want to call Force of Will Spare Condom from now on. But
oh, that's right. We did. I forgot about that. That's why it doesn't. Yeah. That's why none of this sounds familiar, because Spare Condom's not in the list.
Right. Yeah. We may have taken some liberties with the names.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So his shooty blue laser is actually called Arcane Rift. And that shoots, I mean, it shoots, you know, shoots some damage in a direction.
Yeah.
It doesn't stop on the first enemy hit, I believe. It deals damage to all enemies in the path. The other one's Force of Will, which protects your allies from damage for 1.5 seconds.
Single target or group? How does it work?
Single target, right. Although there is a talent called Circle of Protection that will also affect nearby allies, which seems crazy, right? So if you're in that death ball and Kael'thas tosses living bombs in, you put your Circle of Protection around everybody.
That's a big condom. Sounds like a magnum condom is what you're saying. Big one.
Right. Yeah. One for everyone. And
not how they work.
It's magic. This is, magic doesn't have to make sense.
Magic condom, yeah.
And So that protects your ally from damage, but not from CC.
Yeah.
So the other one is the portal. You can pass through a portal that you place to another place, which is also really interesting. His trait is turning into a raven, so he can fly around. And the two ultimates are Polybomb, which sheeps indefinitely, like Living Bomb style.
Yeah.
And the Leyline Seal, which is a void prison that shoots in a line rather than appear in a circle.
Okay, so quick question about the raven form for the trait. You're a big fan of reveal and you know, map visibility and stuff. Mm-hmm. There are many people who are crying OP before he's even on PTR. Do you worry at all that kind of vision, which I know takes him out of the battle and essentially leaves the battlefield one shy while he's in that form, you know, one that's not fighting, do you think it is going to give that character an unfair advantage and we're going to, you know, be one of these sort of immediate patches, oh no, we need to nerf that kind of deals?
Tough to say. It depends how formidable he is, I think. Like, vision is definitely strong, but he's got to take himself out of map presence to give the vision, which is not as good as, say, Zagara creep or Hollow Decoy or, you know, Tassadar's reveal. So I don't think so. I think maybe he'll be strong for other reasons. Basically, all of his utility. If you can leverage how incredible that is with your team, he'll be good.
Yeah.
Right. He might come out as a OP hero, but I don't know if I think it's this that's going to do it. Because when you think about it, Zagara being able to plop her vision down anywhere, she can be somewhere else completely while still supplying full vision to an area. And granted, that's not mobile, but it also frees her up to go and be somewhere else. He has to be where you want the vision. So if you want him to go check boss, he can do that. But if a fight breaks out bottom, he's got to fly himself all the way back down to help out before he can do anything else. And he also flies a little bit slower than what your mount moves. And his vision is not the full radius of vision when he's in Raven form. So it's good, no doubt. But I don't think that it's so good that we can probably say it's guaranteed OP, you know, when it comes out.
Okay. Well, I'm very interested in him. I want to see him in action. I think this might be one of the heroes I give it a little time on and see what people say. I don't know if that means I was burned a little bit by Chromie or something, but I feel like I'm limping a little bit from that. Not that she isn't fun or that she won't eventually be worth the $10 I threw at it, but or the, excuse me, the 22 or whatever I paid for the combo. But she's kind of horrible right now in terms of, you know, winning games or doing anything for your team. And wait and see. But now I feel like waiting and seeing a little bit. It's not that I don't trust Blizzard. Sometimes they blow it out of the water and Lee Ming comes out of nowhere and you're like, oh my gosh, it's the best character ever. Let's ban her forever in Hero League. But then once in a while, Lunar will come out kind of broken and they'll eventually fix her and probably should have waited on that one. So I don't know who's going to suck her down out of the three of us and pick her up first. Or who has the gold.
I'll get him first for sure.
Yeah.
Well, first, but I mean, I'm going to buy him day and date. But you don't have to do that kind of thing. I think it's actually prudent, especially when you have a lot of other heroes that, like Lili, you would like to play, and more murky.
More murky. Here are the players or the characters I want to play more of. More murky, more, what's his, Zul, more Lili, and more to Arthas now that he's been reworked. I want to mess around with him some. So it's not like I don't have a bunch of heroes that are just sitting there waiting to be used and played. And I feel like maybe this is a window for me to kind of chill a little bit on the hot newness, let somebody else mess with that, give me their opinions, see how it works out in the meta, see what happens on hots logs and win rates and all that, rather than just assume that it's rad right out of the gate. And see what happens, you know, and just mess around with some of these other characters. So that's my plan. We'll see.
Yeah, I'll probably pick him up. But these two were probably the two coolest I've been going into a new hero launch. Chromie, when she was announced, you know, I was excited because there was the whole dragon aspect, literally, part to it. And but turns out they didn't lean very heavily into that. And so I kind of cooled on Chromie real quick. And Medivh is this big utility character. I like him in concept, but it's very difficult for me to play utility characters. I tend to play Warrior, which tends to be kind of the playmaker. And it's very hard for me to say, okay, well, I'm going to hang back and just support and not be up in the fray. So I'm a little hesitant on Medivh. I don't expect him to gel with me, but I'm still going to probably pick him up.
All right. Well, there's him. That's happening. Go ahead, Bo.
Well, yeah, I just want to say also, you can buy them with gold.
That's true. Is that what you're going to do?
I have mostly. I may or may not. It depends how badly I want a master skin. I haven't decided yet.
I got Chromie with gold.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, there you go. So, you know, you got a free arrow. If it didn't work out, that's fine.
Probably not next week, week after? Is that the current guesstimation on when we get them?
I thought
them?
It was next week.
Next Tuesday?
My guess would be it would come with the ranked revamp. Would be my guess.
That's what I would think, is they would try to have a hero with that. But maybe that revamp's such a big deal that they don't actually want a new hero to muddy up matchmaking or screw up even quick play during a time where they...
I've sworn this has been actually confirmed. They may have said... I'll look for it and I'll chime in if I find it.
Okay.
No worries.
All right. One other thing to mention is that he has a cool talent at 20 where he can give someone else 20 seconds of invisibility.
Which
I think is kind of awesome.
That seems, I'm trying to think. That would be, man, that'll be rough if you play that right. If you play in some nice team play and you do something with, like, say, who would it be? Who would you make?
And I have dreams of ETC getting invisibility and going into mosh pit the group while they're unsuspecting, you know, and then the rest of the team comes and blows them up.
Is it possible?
That would be pretty awesome.
But what you're saying is, even if he's invisible, while he's invisible, you can still attack and stuff, right? It's not like a normal stealth where you break stealth if you attack. Or is it?
If you take damage, it's just like the other stealth.
Oh, it is
the
like
character.
That. Okay. All right.
Yeah, I'm kind of hoping, and here's the other thing, invisibility has a 10-second cooldown, but it lasts for 20 seconds.
Oh, wow.
So you're going to be able to do this a lot. Everyone on the team is going to be Nova. I just think this talent's going to be really cool.
So in theory, could you have like a 10-second span where there are two characters on the team that you've made invisible that don't normally have stealth?
Yes, at second 10 of the first person being stealth, you can apply it to a second person.
Oh. That's crazy. It's,
there's just a lot of neat things here that don't translate into deal 10% more damage if you say Ashaladore 10 times. Mm-hmm. You know, like all these things, all the talents here, it's worth having a look. Seem like they make all of his utility more
Useful. More better.
Yeah, more yeah, better.
I like more better.
They make them more better. So,
John, do you find any confirmation there?
I think you guys are right. I think it's 2 weeks.
All right. Two weeks.
But still not 100% confirmed.
All right. Keep saying 2 weeks until your head separates into chunks, and then you're Arnold Schwarzenegger underneath. We've been a year in the storm, folks. One full freaking year since retail full release of the game. Well, that is to say post-beta, which for us was literally flip a switch, and we're still playing the game. But 50% XP event is June 2nd through the 14th, so that's this Thursday through the 14th. You will get 50% bump in XP that stacks with your group XP and stims that you have already. So if you've already got a stim pack, a year long, a month or a 3 month or whatever, those will carry over as well. So this is a great time to be leveling those characters like Bo's doing. I plan on playing a bunch of that during that time. Anniversary bundle is out and an anniversary portrait. The bundle is crap. I had it. Where is it? Is it in this list? It is.
There's a Zool, link there to it. Yeah.
Yeah, there it is. Okay, we got, here it is. Arthas. Arthas, Hammer, Morales, Uther, Zool, walk into a bar. Just kidding. What's his name? Butcher, Kerrigan, and Artanis, and Tyrael's Charger mount, which is a badass mount for sure. And then you get a stim pack with that as well. That's a 7-day stim pack, I should say. And that is a bundle. How much is that one? Do we know the price? We don't know.
No, it just they says, haven't said.
It says deep discounts, whatever that means. But yeah.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a good price. I think this is going to be like your starter bundle, but for the anniversary. So I think this will be worth, if I had to guess, these are going to be worth it. These look like there's not a lot of high-value heroes in here in terms of sales, probably. Yeah,
probably going to be a good deal. And also the portrait, which looks like a Nexus cake with a 1 on it to celebrate 1 year. You get that simply by logging in during the bonus XP time. So you need to log in and get it. That doesn't seem like much work to me. So do that and get another portrait. Because why not? Portraits, they're a thing. Try to collect them
all. Did you ever get Tyrael's Charger?
I did. I love it. It's amazing.
Okay. I'm just making sure. You know, we got to check in every now and then to see if we can make you spend money on the show.
Nice try. No, I bought, I don't remember what, I think it may have been another bundle or something, but I picked it up and it's, I have a recommendation for that mount. You do it in the dark blue color and have Jaina in her master skin, also the dark blue. It is a rad combo. So it's crossing two different IPs in the Nexus, but it looks like it fits perfectly, and Jaina just rocks that thing. So do that. Also,
can I be super wow nerd for a second?
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, actually, if you did the year-long subscription deal, you could get Tyrael's Charger in WoW. So canonically speaking, Tyrael's Charger is actually a World of Warcraft item.
So I have that in WoW. Oh, you're right, because it never shows up in Diablo.
Yeah.
I have that in WoW, but I didn't get it that way. How did I get it?
It was that, what was the thing? You had to say you were going to be subscribed for a year.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I don't remember
what they
called
that. Right. The 12 months meant you got Diablo, the core edition of Diablo for free.
Yeah.
If you were a WoW sub for a year. You know, at the time and when they announced that at BlizzCon and I was in the audience for that, that seemed like the coolest idea. Like, oh my gosh, what a rad idea, because I was going to do this anyway. Oh, sweet, I'm getting a free game out of this. I look back on it now, it's a little weird if you think about it. Like, subscribe to our other totally different game, and we'll give you this other completely separate, totally different game. It's weird.
I think it worked because it was Diablo. Like, I don't think they had as many games being pushed. Right? Like, they couldn't do it now. Subscribe to a year, and we'll give you 60 packs of Hearthstone cards.
Well, yeah, and you're right, because there was no Hearthstone then. Heroes, I don't even think had been announced. If it had been, it was just still being known as Blizzard Dota or whatever. Or Blizzard All-Stars or whatever it was at that point. So there was no like idea when that was going to come out. So you're probably right. It was like StarCraft, Diablo coming out. So that was 2012? Yeah. That was 2011. Mm-hmm. And the game came out the following summer, which was the year we would have got the credit for it, and there was no BlizzCon that year. I got it all figured out now. My brain's working.
Well, you will be spending money because I know you'll want this Hellbilly mount that's coming out as well.
Yeah.
Which you have to make a real money purchase in the shop to get the Hellbilly mount. And you probably have Billy the Kid, but if you don't have Billy the Kid, he's retiring from the Nexus on June 14th. But if you buy something, you'll get the Hellbilly and Billy the Kid during that two-week period. So get your wallets ready.
Collect all the, and you don't have to buy the bundle. You can buy anything. So if you buy a 2,000 coin cheap for the week, Tychus or something, whatever, that's enough for that. Or no, I'm sorry, not coins, but money. You have to spend money. So let's say it's $4.99. Yeah, or a skin. $4.99 for Zul's snake skin right now is on sale. I could buy that during the period. I won't do it yet, but yep. I'll buy it during that period. Boom. Free Billy mount from hell.
Hellbilly.
And now I've got all the Billies. So
Rainbow Billy, Wonder Billy, Hellbilly.
Yeah, that's a...
Wasn't there a Poverty Billy, too?
Was there? I think Billy the Kid is the Poverty Billy.
Yeah, but you still had to spend real money to get that Billy.
Oh.
No, I know Billy, because I thought Billy the Kid was a little magical.
I spent food stamps. I get some food stamps and trade it for Billy, the Poverty Billy. That's terrible.
Well, whatever. Hellbilly is probably going to be the best iteration. He's on fire.
Yeah, it looks real cool. It's a real, like, I don't know how to describe the effect. It might just not be translating over the website, but there's a real, like, stutteriness to the effect that mm-hmm. I actually really like. Mm-hmm. There's something about the animation as they're showing it that's not super smooth, and I kind of like how it looks. Mm. So I don't know if that's going to translate when it ultimately comes out, but I'm actually kind of excited for it because, you know, there's nothing more fun than putting the butcher on a little billy goat.
Yeah, especially one from hell. So it's a little more matchy to his origins. It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Anyway, so that's all something you can do. There is a Reddit Q&A about Ranked Play revamp coming up on Tuesday. That's on the 7th, 12 p.m. That's a week from today. Pacific Data Time. Data Time. Daylight Time. You know, Pacific Data Time. You guys. Anyway, there are going to be a bunch of people answering questions. People like Johnny Waterman, the UI artist, Gloria Zhang, the game producer, and many, many others. If you want to go and do this Q&A, then I guess do it. It's just part of the... what's the fastest way for people to get there? Just the Heroes of the Storm subreddit? Is that the best way?
Yeah, go to the Heroes, the Reddit of the Storm. That's what they like to call it. I think it's cool.
Yeah.
And go. You have to be there. They're going to open a thread on June 7th. So there's a thread right now announcing it. Don't post your questions there. Save them. Put them in Notepad and save them on your desktop. And then when it comes time, you can post them on the thread that opens up on that day.
Yep.
I've asked questions before. They've gone unanswered. And I'm always like, don't you know who I am? But I've got one karma point. I'm pretty sure they're like, oh, here's a poor vassal. We'll just ignore him.
Yeah, they usually are pretty good about spreading it around, but I guess we'll see. This is an important moment for them, this revamp for ranked play. So I'm mm-hmm. very, very curious about this Q&A and how it goes and what is asked and how they answer. And all you people that want to come in there and flood the thing with legacy servers, don't do that. That's for WoW. Go to another place and do that. Those people are everywhere, by the way. Legacy server people. Everywhere.
The version of Heroes of the Storm that has Haunted Mines in
it. Yeah, that's the one. I want. Can I go back to the day where Haunted Mines was cool? No, because it didn't exist. All right. Bo, you found an interview with MVP Black's coach, Coach Kim. They refer to him as. Says they may not return to Heroes. And give us the quick and dirty why. And I know why, and I don't like it, but I want to hear it from you since you found this.
Well, you know, MVP Black has a pretty strong reputation, and their team in Heroes of the Storm has one. And this guy, Coach Kim, I never heard of him before reading this interview. Mm. But I was like, oh, well, here's someone who's invested in making the team champions, right? Mm-hmm. And there's some cool stuff in there, ultimately, that he is interested in, you know, bringing on new talent, where his approach to the game isn't finding pro players already in the scene and trying to make a team of people with inflated egos work together. He likes to grow new talent and feed that into the community. That's sort of his goal, which seemed very cool. Also very interesting from a, you know, how would you build a team? That seems like an interesting game to play.
Sure.
And so the team is doing very well, but then the big takeaway from this is that he doesn't believe that MVP Blacks players will want to continue playing Heroes after this year, that they've won a considerable amount of tournaments so far, and that they're not arrogant about their chances, but their goal is to win BlizzCon this year. But the fact is that teams don't subsist off of winnings, and the winnings aren't ample enough to even, say, make that a possibility, where 1v1 StarCraft games have higher prize pools per person than a 5v5 game does. And there are bigger fish in the esports pool. And the statement is that basically, like, I can't keep these young players that I'm bringing up from wanting to go to more lucrative fields where they can get sponsorship. And there's monetary support behind keeping sports running. And that the opinion is currently Blizzard, or, you know, you got to say, I kind of don't want to target Blizzard esports or whoever's responsible for fostering this, mm-hmm. is not providing a sufficient framework to make this a viable long-term decision for people who want to play Heroes as a sport.
Right.
And I think people consider this a little more based on who he is, and I don't think he's a grandstanding type of individual from what I understand in the comments. So, yeah, I thought this made me react specifically to it, because this is the game I love. I don't love League of Legends. I don't love Dota 2. I like this game. And I'm not going to lie, sometimes I worry about my passion for the game, because I'm like, I'm really invested in playing it. I play it all the time. And it's not to say I want something out of it, like I'm going to be a professional or whatever, but I really, really like it. And I like doing the content that we're doing, for example. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I feel a bit of anxiety over this is, you know, eventually going to derail. And it's not to say that Blizzard doesn't have a track record of supporting its games or being really great in certain regards, but the esports thing is a whole other beast.
Yeah.
And I don't see, right now, personally, I see effort, but I'm not getting a sense yet that this thing has arrived in a big way. You know, when you're constantly bragging about how good you are, but you haven't done anything to prove it that actually sways people's opinion, mm-hmm. for example? Mm-hmm. That's sort of like where I feel we're at. It's a great game. Everyone loves it. There are passionate people up with it, passionate people involved in it. But I'm not seeing that love, you know. Mm-hmm. And so that this sort of just further makes me concerned. I don't know how you guys felt about that or feel about Heroes and its health
So I'll say this: Blizzard doesn't. They've never been the kind of company that abandons a project once they are all in on it, meaning they've gone as far as we've published it and we've decided that this is a game we're making, and they've gone to full release out of beta. They've had plenty of projects that they've worked on and then canceled because they didn't feel like it was ready for prime time, but this is one they felt was. And whenever they've gone to that extent, they've never abandoned this stuff. We still get patches for Diablo 2. We still get patches for StarCraft 2 Brood War. Like, weirdly, they are the most supportive game company I'm aware of. And whenever they launch something new, my assumption is if it's out on the market, that game has got like a 20-year lifespan at the least in terms of its them just internally seeing it as relevant, and they'll support it till its dying breath. I also think they thought, because they are Blizzard and they have all these IPs and they have all of these other games feeding into this thing, from an intellectual property standpoint, and because in a lot of ways they are the originator of where all this came from. It was in their backyard that Dota was invented and pulled out and gone on to other things. And if they weren't so freaking busy building World of Warcraft and then maintaining that, they would have had a better handle on seeing that coming. Instead, Riot saw it coming, or people left and started Riot and saw it coming, and to some degree Valve saw it coming. Or saw what was happening and decided to get in on it then and took better advantage of the timing. Blizzard's not the kind of company that's going to turn around and put something half-assed out right away, so they took their time, they polished this thing up, they worked on it for the best they could, for as fast as they could, and they also released it based on a lot of what MOBAs are. We've got towers, we've got gates, we've got lanes, we've got blah. So this, and we've talked about this before, they kind of lifted some of the template, put some of their own spins on it, stuff all of us in this show and a lot of our community absolutely love about the game. But nonetheless, some of it's derivative of what was already out there. So you're a late third in terms of timing of the big three. And we're not even talking about all the dead, rotting bodies of the other MOBAs that came and went and didn't make it. I mean, that DC thing was out for like a week and they canned it. And there's always some new MOBA popping off and mobile's trying to get in on the stuff. So to make a long story short, my opinion is that they are in it for the long haul, that they may have been a little in over their head in terms of grappling with the esports side of things. And I will bet you money that the acquisition of MLB is everything about this. Everything you're talking about, them not having the infrastructure, Coach Kim talking about them not having the lattice work that is needed to support long-term interest of the pro players in the game, is that is all the MLB purchases a direct response to that, in my opinion. Now, whether it was a good purchase or not, whether it actually helped boost things or not, I don't know. That's yet to be seen. But it's funny. It's almost like Blizzard's attention to detail and perfection actually works against them in this case, because it makes them slower. With all of this, you know? Go ahead, John.
I think one of the big problems that Heroes of the Storm has, because I completely agree with what Bo said, sometimes I get really worried about this game, and I don't think I need to be as worried as I am at times. But at the same time, I also don't think there's any reason to throw our hands behind our head and say, well, we did it, everybody. The game's here. Let's all have a good time. I think this game is suffering a little bit from being trapped in a weird place where it was, you know, it started its life as a mod. And originally this was going to be just a fun little mod for StarCraft II, and it was going to be a thing that they made, but you were going to launch it. I mean, they kicked it off with the Protoss Iron Chef game and some form of StarCraft II Bejeweled or whatever it was at that BlizzCon.
Yep.
That's where we first saw it. Like, that was all the attention this was going
to
get.
And remember, this was pre, just to interject real quick, this was pre Dota 2. Valve had not released Dota 2 at this point. So they had a real shot here. So continue. Timing was weird.
Then they expanded on it and they did what Blizzard tends to do. They tend to not be happy with minimum, and they thought, okay, well, we need to push it further and further and further, and then it became its own game, and now we are in a world that has Dota 2, and now we are in a world that's seeing a decline of MOBAs, and now they're saying, oh, well, we got this thing, but it's kind of got one foot back in the legacy department, and it's got one foot stepping forward saying we're going to bring something new to the table. And Heroes of the Storm is a really good game that I feel like is sometimes saddled with some really bad legacy ideas. I think that they should have done a different pricing model. I don't think we should be buying heroes on an individual basis. I don't think it's the right model for the game. And I think if Blizzard hadn't gone with that method, I think they could have maybe done some more unique, fun things with it. I think Blizzard has a really amazing and talented crew of people that are able to put some really just strongly desired content into their game, yet they don't follow what Valve does as far as crowdfunding some of their prize pools, when they could be raking in maybe not Dota 2 money, but they could be making so much more for their players if they just would foster that. But they've made it to where their entire model is based around selling these skins and these characters and all of that, that if they say, oh, we just put in a ton of time and effort to make this really cool skin and this really cool mount that goes with it, they want to collect that money. They don't want to use that as fundraising for an esports group, an organization, an event, even though ultimately that might help it grow. And I think that's unfortunate, because I would love to do half the things that people who are into Dota 2 can do. But like Bo said, Dota 2 isn't the game I care about. I care about this game. Mm-hmm. So when I see people buy their book, whatever it's called, the Necronomicon or whatever the weird thing is they buy for Dota 2, and they go through and they're playing all the mini games and they're crowdfunding and they're unlocking all these cool things for the game and they're getting really involved in the esports scene, I'm looking at it and thinking, man, we could do that, but we need the support from Blizzard to be able to do it, and we just don't have it yet.
Here's a way that, like, because I agree with what you, like, I think the game is healthy. It's more like World of Warcraft PvPers is like, hardcore thing that people love, right? Mm-hmm. But when I watch the BlizzCon like streams or when it happens to be on, it's like, it seems like the weird table in the lunchroom, right? You know, like you're at school and like there's different people with different circles of friends. And then Warcraft PvP is kind of in this weird place. And we don't want to get into that rabbit hole, but I kind of feel like Heroes is occupying that space on a larger scale. It's the weird kids table in the MOBA world. And I know they're making lots of efforts because you've got Heroes of the Dorm, you've got championships going on, but something's not quite right. And I'm not saying I have an answer, but I feel like something about what I read here from Coach Kim. I just love this guy's name. Coach Kim.
Yep. That's what we call Coach my Kim. Wife here at the house, Coach Kim. She takes care of everything.
Something about here, it just sort of hints, like in a negative way, I think, you know, that they can't be slow moving with the esports side of things for this game. I think if there has to be a different philosophy on how they approach this, because it doesn't work like Hearthstone. It doesn't work where like anyone has a chance, and at BlizzCon you might qualify and compete. I think this needs to be more curated and have a stronger backbone, like professional sports, professional entertainment sports, than more of just a contest for customers to come and compete, which is kind of how I view Hearthstone in a way. Even though it's very successful, I just don't think it works for MOBAs.
Well, here's a quote. We'll finish it with this quote here at the end that I think is telling, or at least maybe has some wisdom in it. He says, "I think Blizzard is living in the past. I think every tournament should be following a crowdfunding system like Dota 2. I believe it's a good system that teams, players, and users can all benefit from. I really hope Blizzard will realize that fast." I think he's right. Like, and maybe they are. I know this stuff takes a while to spin up. Riot's had a decade to do it, or whatever it's been. They didn't get there overnight. They didn't do it in a year. Like, we're a year into Heroes of the Storm. I think Blizzard thought the heft of Blizzard and the heft of these IPs and the fact that this is actual Lich King in this thing and these maps are like based on stuff we love and like it's the real deal. It's not some based on some mod that everyone's had to kind of work from the template from. It was Blizzard's chance to say, no, this is like straight up ass Blizzard ass Blizzard. And I think they thought that was going to be enough of a momentum changer to give them a huge boost and a big advantage in the early goings in the way that, say, Overwatch is getting that a bit in the shooter space, for sure. Like, they're getting a major boost out of that game. And they're getting it because it's Blizzard who made it, and it's also a really great game. This is different, though. There are millions, multi-millions, maybe billions in esports, and they are wrapped around the fingers of League of Legends and Dota 2, mostly League of Legends, if we're being honest. Like, Dota 2's got a cool system, and they're making big moves forward, but it's still nowhere like near the League of Legends player base or what they do with tournaments and stuff. So it's like me saying, hey guys, let's start a football league, and in a year we better be competing with the NFL. like, that's kind of what it feels like they tried to do, and maybe they had the best chance of anybody else in the entire gaming business to do it. They probably did. I would have bet on them. If anyone's betting on who's going to do it, I'd bet on Blizzard doing it. But maybe, just maybe, that wall is too high to get in a year.
Well, I think you also have to strike while the iron's hot, and you have to strike on the right things. And I think you're spot on by saying, I bet they placed a lot of emphasis on, no, we're the game that has Thrall. We're the game that has all these characters. People should come here. But they're going to be all the right characters 5 years from now. Mm-hmm. Having a supported and played esports community might not be if they don't strike while that iron's hot. You don't get a second launch.
Yeah.
So you got to grab those people early and you got to push for it, because they'll move on, and then you want to be in the position where they're happy to stick around, not where you're ringing the bell again saying, no, wait, come back, it's better now over here.
Yeah, they did that successfully. They did it successfully with Diablo 3, but and people could point to that and say, well, what about Diablo 3? They came out with Loot 2.0 and that expansion and just killed it. You're right. They improved that game 1,000 times over and fixed everything that was wrong with it. And but that's not the same. That would be the same if there was another company called Ribbit Games who had a game called League of Diablo running or whatever, and they had some huge enormous player base playing a game, and then Diablo 3 comes in with a half-assed product or one that didn't work exactly right, or I had this, you know, it was guilt-strapped by this crappy store system and all that stuff they had in the beginning, they wouldn't have had a second chance the way that they had, because they're still the only game in town. Diablo matters more than any other action RPG on the market. They own that. They own MMOs in the same way. That wasn't a piece of territory. They could get a second chance, is what I'm saying. Maybe not a third, but they got their second chance. I agree with you 100%. You don't get a second chance here. But all of that being said, the thing I'm clinging to here is that Blizzard never abandons this stuff. And they've got the money in the pockets to do it. I wish it felt internally more like it wasn't the... So you talked about being like the weird table at dinner in the mobile world, Bo, mm-hmm. I would say it's the redheaded stepchild of the family a little bit. Whenever I talk to Blizzard people, and I don't want to get specific, but I always get this feeling almost universally that they see it as like this weird necessary thing, but nobody's like staring at the sky and talking about, you know, how awesome Genji is. In the way that they do with Genji. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, there's something about it that says, okay, this is our dirty little secret that we should have been all over this in 2004 and 5, and we didn't do it. And now we're having to make up for lost time, and damn it, it's hard work, and someone's got to knuckle under and do it. And Dustin, keep your ass down so you don't get shot, but keep at it, buddy. And we don't really want to talk about it right now. We're going to go talk about these other things. Like, I just get that feeling across the board. And that part makes me super sad, because it could be pure perception on my part, but it's absolutely a perception I have, and that can't be good if I'm, and there's no way I'm the only person that senses that from.
No, I think you're spot on, and I think nothing perhaps sells that image better, and sorry Bo, I'm throwing you visually under the bus with this one, than this weekend going from my friends list in Overwatch, so chock full of people, everyone playing that game, to clicking on the Heroes tab to see what's going on in there. And every one of the banner advertisements that you can click through is Overwatch related. And there's Bo, the only person on my friends list logged into Heroes of the Storm. Mm-hmm. I feel like the attention has definitely been going in one direction. And they should be proud of Overwatch. It's a hell of a game and a hell of a story. But if anybody feels like, oh man, that's getting a great big spotlight that I don't feel like necessarily was over here, I wouldn't say that was an incorrect perception at any point.
Oh yeah. No, look, they've got movie theater ads, they had giant action figures around the world, they had huge launch events all over the place, deals with Coke, commercials on TV constantly for Overwatch. Like, that was a bona fide, put all our weight behind this thing. None of that happened with Heroes of the Storm. Like,
where's my Coke of the Storm or Coke of the Dorm?
Well, I mean, like, I never saw a single commercial for it. I mean, BlizzCon doesn't count. That's free advertising at their own event. Like, I never saw it outside of the game, the community, and from Blizzard. That's really worrisome, because you still see television spots for Legion. That's going to happen. It happened for Warlords. It'll happen for Legion. Like, expansions for other games, you can bet Diablo would get a bigger push in the media. It's just not being handed to them. And I don't know if that's all. Like, maybe if I got there internally, it'd feel very different, and they don't feel this way at all. But I bet that team feels like, all right, well, we're just gonna do this hard work over here and build this rad game and do the best we can, because it's almost better that we're making something to compete in this weird MOBA space, because if we didn't do something, someone else will just fill the void anyway. So we may as well just do something, and maybe they see it as a lost leader. I don't know. Like, I don't know.
Well, yeah, but it's also, I mean, it's not 100% on them. Like, they could make every sponsorship deal in the world, and still the people have to want to play. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Blizzard are very good at making good games and bringing people into the game. So it's very easy for us, too, to also just lay it all at Blizzard's feet. But what I read into this is that the support structure around the game, like the sponsorship and all the money that doesn't come from Blizzard, that, you know, that Coke wants to give, or that, I don't know, Nike may finally sponsor an esport. Like, that's that culture around it. There's a lot of money in a very few games, and the passionate people who like Heroes want it to be that. And I don't know if we're getting told that it's just not happening. And that's where the anxiety comes from, is that there's, for whatever reason, there's not enough interest at, on that level. People might log in and enjoy playing the game, but what needs to be done to bring it to that level for those of us passionate enough who want everyone to play this MOBA and tell Riot to go take a hike, basically? Well,
yeah,
like,
and Riot has, they have the zeitgeist going on. It's kind of, it's just hard. Like, how do you become, it happens sometimes in gaming, how do you become the thing that, that finally makes id Software look like less than they used to be? Well, you call yourselves Epic Games and you make an engine called Unreal and you come out in 1999 and blow everyone's minds. Or 97, whatever it was, with Unreal and then later Unreal Tournament. And then now you're actually competing. Like, you've made a game that is arguably better than the King of the Hill. I think that's what Blizzard thought they were doing. And I think at the end of the day, they created something that I think is a whole lot better than those other games. But those players have the zeitgeist. They're the ones with the momentum because it already existed before Blizzard poked its nose in there. And there's hard to stop that. Like,
yeah,
it doesn't matter how big you are, and sometimes the bigger you are, the harder that is, because people are starting thinking of you as just a big corporate, you know, money machine that doesn't care what players think anymore. Whether that perception's wrong or not, it doesn't matter. That's what they think. Yeah. I know a lot of Dota players who just freaking hate Blizzard. It's like, well, all right.
I don't know why.
But they'd play it if the zeitgeist was there. I wouldn't listen to anyone saying stuff like that, because if they play the games that they play because that's where everyone is. Mm-hmm. You know, that's just sort of that. That's why a lot of people, that's why I started playing World of Warcraft. I wanted to go to an MMO where people were around. It's not my first choice of MMO. Planetside 1 was, but nobody plays that game.
Yeah.
So I have this stigma where I constantly fall in love with social games with communities outside of them. They're always small. Yeah. And then, like, I have an extra anxiety. But is Heroes going to be another game like this? You know, like, I really like Heroes. Mm-hmm. There's no question. It's just, you know, if there is something that they can do to support the esports community and support community events in a larger way,
yeah,
I'd like for them to do it. And I'd like for them not to take a long time to do it.
Because
I think the Blizzard philosophy of game making doesn't work for the community side of things. I think that has to be a different philosophy, because people don't wait. It's just not the it's never been, I think, the nature of media to be that way and for communities to be that way.
Well,
so,
especially something like esports where it's moving at the speed of light and there's so much.
And they're doing a lot. It's not to say they aren't doing a lot, right?
No. I don't think any of us are saying that.
They're putting out a new hero every 2 to 3 weeks.
No, but I mean on the esports side. I don't mean on the development side. I mean it's not the game. It's what we're doing with the game. I think that's what I'm picking on, right?
Yeah.
So, you know,
it's the same. You know what it feels like to me? This is what I have the perfect example, and this is why it makes me feel a little sour sometimes. It's reminiscent of the feeling I had every time Microsoft would go, "Oh shit, we thought iPods weren't going to work, but look at them now. Okay, quick, what do you want to do? How about the Zune? All right, we'll support that."
I knew you were about to call Heroes of the Storm the Zune.
And I don't want to call it that, because as far as here's the problem, though. The Zune's actually a pretty good media player. It was real good. And had it launched 3 years earlier, they would have been probably a much more competitive product. But they were late to the game in such a way that it made it seem like it was just a bad choice to do it when they did it. Same thing with their acquisition of Nokia, same thing with the Lumia phone, same things with Windows Phone in general. Like, Microsoft's foray into mobile, listening to Steve Ballmer talk smack about how no one's going to buy a smartphone, nobody wants touch, they want, you know, this sweet keyboard on these Windows phones we have or whatever. And then he turned out to be dead freaking wrong when he said that in 2007. And so I'm not saying Steve Ballmer is anything like Blizzard or that Morheim and crew or anything like Steve Ballmer. I'm just saying that feeling of, okay, we got to hurry up and get in here. Oh, I thought we had a chance, but I guess it didn't. You know, like, that's the feeling I'm getting. And I don't like that at all. And it has nothing to do with the game. This isn't a rushed product. This isn't a piece of crap. It's a great video game.
With, compared to the Zune, which by all accounts is a great product. I didn't have one, but I've heard the poor Zune fans out there to this day are probably still like, man, if only... I wish I was in an alternate future where Zune
Succeeded. Dominant. Exactly.
Please, Time Lords, please transport me to this version of the future.
Yeah, so but Microsoft succeeds in so many ways, just as Blizzard does. I'm not calling them Atari, so save your emails. It's a different animal, but... Anyways, go ahead, John.
I can totally relate to this, though, because I'll tell you this much. If Heroes folds, for whatever reason, if for some reason they're just done, they pull out of the game, servers go down, sorry guys, we tried, we didn't make it, I'm going to be extra bummed, because that's probably, I will probably never play a MOBA again. Because I've played League of Legends, I kind of played Dota 2, and I thought about getting into them the other day. I was looking at it. I was like, yeah, you know what? I had some fun there. Maybe I should try it. And then I thought, oh, yeah. But there's all these things that Heroes does way better that I can't go back to ever again.
Yeah.
And there's no way I would go back to it. So I really hope that it continues to do well. But let me end what I have to say on this topic on a hopeful message, because I feel like maybe we've been a little too dour. Mm-hmm. So here's my positive message of hope for everybody. I have never known a video game company to be more willing to say, well, we screwed up, we're going to do whatever it takes to fix it.
Mm-hmm.
And if it turns out that MOBAs in general are on the outswing, and they're just not going to grow, and it's not going to be a market that's going to go anywhere, I can guarantee you that Blizzard is going to be the company that looks at it and says, how can we take what we have here and make something new and awesome out of it? And in a wasteland where everybody's dying, Blizzard is, this is a terrible analogy, Blizzard is that cockroach that survives and says, nope. We're going to rebuild. We're going to make this even better. Yeah. You know, and I don't know what form that takes. Maybe it doesn't even look like a MOBA as we see it. You know, maybe in 5 years from now, not a single map we're playing on is the map that we have. Maybe we're playing with different amounts of players and all the rules have changed. But if that's what it takes, they're the company that will do it. And I don't know if you can say that about the other two.
I would agree with that. That's the stake that I plant in the ground and say, I'm painting this blue and white because it's Blizzard, and they don't do that. They don't drop it. Now, that's the one difference between my Microsoft analogy. The sense of the feeling of lateness to the market is there, but the abandoning of the platform like Microsoft did in numerous cases, not just Zune, that doesn't happen at Blizzard. They've yet to do it. And they could have easily just let Diablo 3 and its problems die on the vine. They could have just stuck to that stupid store stuff and said, we're never changing this. And instead, they had this coming to Jesus moment, and they made it right, man. In every possible way, they made it right. And can keep making it right for free. They keep making it right. And writer. Every couple months, there's something more right about that game. So I trust them. And the game's not broken. That's the thing. I want to reiterate that. Bo's right. The game is healthy. It is a strong-ass game. The characters are great. What they're doing to it is great. This revamp looks good and smart. There's so much happening that is great about the game. It's impossible to fix their lateness to the dance. But they can still do a break dance and spin around on their heads at the end of this dance and blow everybody away and get nominated prom queen and king.
There's. I think it will be a strong game, and I really do hope that we haven't heard a map announcement in a while, so maybe they're identifying this anxiety that we're feeling. Because I think if you're passionate about this game and you're honest, and we all have been at one point or another, we've considered, like, yeah, it'll be a supported game, but will this become more awesome? Mm-hmm. You know, and I think maybe just the way we are nowadays too affects it. Like, the Twitch viewer numbers has an impact. For some reason, it sucks not seeing it up there, like Hearthstone and Overwatch, you know, to some extent. So, I don't know. I think they may be strategizing, hopefully. But yeah, I'm hopeful for the future, too. But I'm not going to lie. I have my anxieties. And when I read something like this, they perk up.
Especially from somebody who's you know, that guy's...
They're the best team in the world.
Yeah,
right,
the best
now.
Team in the world. It's like, not, yeah.
Like, oh, we don't think we're going to play Heroes because, you know, we're poor.
It's like the Denver Broncos going, I don't know if we're going to play NFL football next year. I think we're going to move to Europe and because it's just not, it's not working. Like, that's a bad thing to hear the pros say when you're trying to establish an esports legacy. And I know that's why they bought MLB, but man, that doesn't ensure anything. We haven't heard anything about that since that happened, by the way. Nothing.
Just to clarify, it's MLG. They didn't
I
buy
keep
the
saying MLB.
Game.
Gosh dang it.
I just want our listeners no, to not
I know.
Be rushing over to Google, feel like, what the heck? What did I miss?
Yeah, I keep saying that. They bought the entire Major League Baseball. Good job, guys. All right.
Baseball is going to get awesome.
It is.
Listen,
indeed.
Nothing we're doing is working. We got to do something out of the box. What should we do?
Whatever
Let's
it
buy
takes.
Baseball.
Whatever
I mean,
takes.
It worked for Nintendo, right? They bought the Mariners for no good reason.
No, that's right. They did. Sold them now. I forgot about yeah. that. Yeah, they don't have them anymore, right?
Yeah, no, but they had them for a time.
Well, they had that Wii money. That Wii money was good for a while.
I'm curious if they did they buy the Mariners before or after Ken Griffey Jr. Baseball?
I think it was after, right? I think so. I don't know. But that was a great game. If we can come out of anything out of this long heart-to-heart we've had with ourselves and Heroes is that Ken Griffey Jr. Baseball was really good.
That's really, really good.
Yeah, it was a great, great game. All right, let's do this. Got a phone call and an email to take care of today. Calls come to us at 801-471-0462. You can email us, core@heroesforyou.com. And it begins with a call about relegation.
Hey, Scott, this is Jake for the Core Show. Just listening to you guys talk about the new league system that's coming out, and you guys keep using the phrases promotion and demotion. I'd say you guys would sound way cooler if you used the traditional soccer terms from transiting from one league to the other by saying promotion and relegation. So relegation would be getting kicked down to the league right below you, and promotion would be, of course, going up to the league above you. Anyway, just giving you guys a tip to sound cooler later.
Isn't it just semantics, though? Don't they mean the exact same thing?
Well, it's better, though. He's right.
It is semantics, and one semantic is cooler than the other one, I think.
Yeah, really want to tell somebody you've been relegated to Clown Town.
All right, you could say that anytime. I think that's fine. We got an email from Woodchip, or Nate. He goes by Woodchip, #11735 on the game. So if you want to find him, you can play him. Scott and friends, love the show. Keeps me sane driving up I-15 in the mornings. Last episode, you mentioned that other MOBAs aren't doing quest talents. I just wanted to note that both League and Dota have similar mechanics, even if they aren't labeled as talents. Below is a list of items and heroes that have quest-type mechanics associated with them. Thought you might find it interesting. In League of Legends, there's something called the Rengar Bone Tooth Necklace, or that's for the character Rengar. Is that based on Rhaegar?
No, Rengar is a character that came before Rhaegar. Okay. He's a wolf man.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so he's a wolf
Rhaegar man. Wears a wolf head. This guy is a wolf man. He's like a permanent gray man.
All right, how about...
So, lore, Rengar killed... Rhaegar killed Rengar and wears his skin upon his head. It's lore. You can't argue with lore.
Blizzard wins this fight. Yeah. Draven has a passive League of Draven... Tear of the Goddess, something like that. Anyway, there's a bunch of these listed. No one, they're not going to make sense to anyone. But there are like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them for League. And Dota has 2, the Urn of Shadows and Bloodstone, which are items. And they are quest-type items.
Where you have to the Bloodstone from eating at Chipotle.
Oh, every time. Every time. So, yeah. Well, I mean, I don't think we ever implied that these mechanics didn't exist anywhere. I think all we've really said is that Blizzard is leaning into them and is very specific about the kind of implementation they are. So,
The point of talents is that it's simpler.
Yeah.
You just click the talent and you're done. Mm. With these games, you do get that, but you have to buy, you know, a BF sword and a little health gem or something, and then you build it into a master sword, and then you got to build this other little thing into, I don't know, shield of Reckoning or something. I don't know the name. And then you build that thing finally into the talent. Effectively, you get the talent when you build it all the way up. It's, you know, unnecessary.
Have you, he goes on to say something else, which I'll say in a second, but do you think that kind of part of our conversation earlier, if Blizzard would have leaned in completely on the very stat-heavy, item-heavy construction of a MOBA, last hit, all the stuff that we I don't like about MOBAs, but a lot of the MOBA core players seem to like. Do you think that would have made a difference? Do you think that would have made things better or worse for Blizzard at this stage if they would have embraced all that crap?
I think it would have been worse.
Yeah.
I think it would have been seen as copycat. I think they did the right thing by taking their own route this way. Mm-hmm. The talent system is one of the best features of the game, I think.
Yeah.
I don't think it would be better. I think the issues with Heroes is not the design of the game, but what we're doing with it. Mm. What they're doing with it. Yeah.
Do you agree, John?
I know a lot of people who gave Heroes a try because it was different. Mm. I think the problem in a lot of those cases, because not a lot of them still play the game, is that I think they had some problems with retention. Because in all those cases, I don't know anybody that tried the game and was like, nah, it's everybody came across and was like, oh yeah, if I played MOBAs, that would be the MOBA I would play. Mm-hmm. But the problem is they're still saying the if I played MOBAs part. So I feel like it maybe addressed one part of the issue, but not the other. But I can speak for myself and say that if they had leaned into that, I wouldn't be here. That's exactly the stuff that I hated about those other games.
I agree. I wouldn't be playing it, and I wouldn't have a show about it. We would not be doing the show together. I wouldn't have met Bo. John and I would still just be great buddies. Like, it would have been a different world. Like, I want to make that real clear. Their decisions to go the directions they went are hugely important to me on a personal level. But also on a professional level, I'm glad they took risks in ways that made the game different. At the end of the day, it may prove out that some of it's not different enough. I don't know.
You hear that, raid team? Scott would still be raiding with you for what
he was. Maybe.
I don't know. He might have jumped off a cliff by this point, yeah. as a poet.
Oh, and Overwatch would have come and killed it for me anyway at some point. So yeah. I mean, but you know, Heroes is still way up there. It's the number one thing on my thing. Like right there, I've got them. I always have them in the list of the order that I'm playing the most right now. I have on my Battle.net. I have Heroes. Then it goes Overwatch. Then it goes Diablo, and then WoW, and then StarCraft, and that's basically will give you an idea of what I'm playing the most. Oh, and Hearthstone's down there too, somewhere at the bottom. I don't play it very much.
Yeah, that's about mine. Let me just complain about that for a second, though.
Go ahead.
They need to make it to where it patches in order of how I have them listed, because nothing frustrates me more. I know this is like the nittiest of nits to pick, but. I hate logging in. I'm like, okay, I want to get into Heroes. My friends are playing Heroes. I got to get into Heroes. And I log in, and it's like, World of Warcraft has started a download.
Yeah.
Why are you updating that right now? I don't even have an active subscription. Yeah. Stop it.
Yeah.
And then it's World of Warcraft Alpha has started an update. Okay. StarCraft 2 has started an update.
Yeah.
Please stop. Hearthstone has started an update. All of these things are at the bottom of my list. I need you to download the Chromie patch, and then I can go.
Yeah.
So,
it is weird that it does. Maybe it's getting, you know, it's like, sorry, Team 4, or are they Team 4? No, they're Team 3, whatever they are. What are they?
Team 1.
Team 1? Are they Team 1?
I don't know.
Sorry, Team 1, or Team whatever you are, Team Browder. Just, you guys get patched last, sorry. Like, I don't know. Like, these are bad impressions people can get.
I think you can just turn off automatic updating and then put the power in your hands.
That's actually true.
The chat room has said there's a way to fix that. Uninstall WoW. Yeah, all right. I do go back enough to maybe not go with that option.
Yeah, I'm in there enough.
I do appreciate the thought on it.
Yeah, we're there enough to leave it on. You got to leave it in there. All right. He finally says this. I really enjoy looking at how other games in the genre take ideas and cues from their competitors. Have you seen the new changes to the Dragon in League of Legends? Very reminiscent of a Heroes of the Storm objective. Good luck with the show. See you in the Nexus. I haven't been paying attention to that, but Bo, do you know anything about this Dragon in League of Legends?
Well, I know I think it was Season 5 of League, they changed the Dragon to actually give a buff. Like, every time you killed it, you would get a different kind of a buff, and then if you killed it 5 times, you got a really powerful buff. So it's objective like in that there are certain points in the match where you go for it and other people try to deny it from you. So it's always, that game has had its objectives. It's just the map isn't like, it's time for the dragon, mortals. Go visit the dragon and kill him. It's up to the players to decide when and where they're going to do that. They're going to attempt that. So
I agree.
Yeah, I think it's like a boss. The bosses are basically like the dragon, except they give buffs to the team. If they've changed it since then, I haven't been keeping up, so I'm not.
Well, sure. And you know, consider the source material, the original mods that all these games are based on, were all inspired by hero mechanics that came out of Warcraft 3. So if anything, Blizzard, you know, they hold the keys to all the cars. Really, they just missed the boat. When look at all my mixed metaphors.
Yeah, that went.
These are terrible. All right.
By car and by boat.
Thanks, Nate, for your email and everybody who sends in their feedback. Again, it's core@heroesforyou.com for the email address. If you want to leave a voicemail like our first caller, 801-471-0462. As a reminder, we don't do this very often, but if you get the show on iTunes or whatever directory you use to get your podcast, wherever that may be, most of them have rating systems. 5-star reviews on iTunes and other services really help us in ways that I cannot tell you enough about. It really does help us. It helps our ranking, helps us show up and be more discoverable. It helps a whole lot. So if you like the show,
helps
and like
other listeners.
Yeah, that's true.
Other listeners.
Yeah, and it helps you ultimately. Listen. You know, like it helps everything grow, and that means the show's better for you, those who are already dedicated to it. So yeah, 5 stars on iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts, that'd be really appreciated. I think it's going to do it for us. We are going to play a chat room. We're going to play some. I think we should play Heroes after this, is what I think. Let's play some Heroes. We're going to play. So if you're around, you can watch us. We're going to keep streaming that. Heroesforyou.com is our website. You can join us in the game at @joinfrogpants. There's a big gaming group in there. I hope they bring something like that to Overwatch soon because that game needs it. core@heroesforyou.com is the email. I already mentioned that. Core Heroes on Twitter. John_Jagger on Twitter. You can find Bo at Bo Schwartz and me at Scott Johnson. That's going to do it for us, for me, for John, for Bo. We'll see you next week. This show is part of the Frog Pants Network. Get more at frogpants.com.